assign you a homework assignment. This will be, I think, easier, deliberately easier than the other ones, so there won't be as much work involved, but there also will be less time, so that way. Basically, I want to touch on the networking stuff, so I'm gonna have you do a cool networking project, learning about how to play with packets and do that kind of stuff. And then I'm also gonna set you up because I want the next assignment is gonna be related to application security, which we're gonna talk about of how to try to actually exploit applications. So the second part of the assignment will actually get you just familiar with playing around with a Linux environment and trying to find flags and this kind of stuff. I've done this in my 545 class, and it was really helpful to get students up to speed for what they need for the next assignment, and that should be pretty cool. All right, so back to networking. So we talked about denial of service attacks on Tuesday, and we've been talking about the fact that if an adversary can ever cause another system to consume more resources, either in terms of memory, bandwidth, CPU, storage, whatever, if I can trigger that functionality, then, or if I can, let's say, I'm caught up here, okay. If I can send one byte and make you store a megabyte, that's a nice lever that I can use to send 1,000 bytes and make you store whatever that conversion is, because I can't do that in my head a lot. So, and so this was so SYN flooding attacks are a very common type of denial of service attack, which the idea, as we talked about, is the attacker sends a SYN packet, the victim then replies with what? SYNACK, replies with a SYNACK packet, and then the attacker does nothing, stays completely silent, right? Or sends another SYN packet. And if we, as an attacker, don't care about getting the reply back, what does that mean we can do with this SYN packet? Drop it? Wait, what? The SYN packet, we have to send it to the server.
Yeah, but as the attacker, you don't care about the response, so you can drop it. And that, was that the question you were asking?
Kind of, yes. So we don't care about the response, so we don't care about the SYNACK coming back to us, right? We're just going to send a SYN packet.
Just keep hitting with SYN.
So we can keep sending them with no limit except for our bandwidth going out. What else?
We could analyze their sequence numbers and try and attack them and go down.
We just want to take them down. We actually don't care about that at all. Yeah.
We can change the source so they don't send them back to us.
We can actually spoof the source IP so that they look like they're coming from all over the world, and actually they wouldn't know that they're necessarily coming from one host, right? Because we don't care about getting that packet back, we can spoof the source address. And so, A, this helps us not DOS ourselves, because if we're sending out a bunch of SYN packets and then we got a bunch of SYNACKs coming in, that could be a problem. But we can actually spoof the source IP because we deliberately do not care about completing the SYN-SYNACK-ACK cycle. Right? All we're trying to do is get the server to store data because we send a SYN packet. And so the idea is, because of this, the operating system will limit the number of what they call half-open connections. So a half-open connection is you send a SYN, the server sends back a SYNACK, and it's waiting for that final ACK. So there's a fixed number, which means that the server will drop any other SYN packets and not process them. Therefore, nobody else can actually connect to the server. So, how do we fix this, or can it be fixed? Is it a fundamental limitation of TCP? Yeah?
Can your implementation just have a fixed size number of connections that you can handle at once and make a queue, and if you get too many in the collection, just start dropping out the older ones? I mean, I guess it doesn't really solve anything, but
like you fill up your queue, right?
You can fill up your queue. Your service is still being denied, but at least like it's your implementation. You understand why it's being denied.
Okay.
That would be my first guess.
All right. And so let's focus on actually fixing the problem from a security perspective. But yeah, that's a good first guess. Yeah.
So set a time limit to where if you don't get an acknowledgement back on your SYNAC, that it'll automatically drop, so you wouldn't be, hopefully you wouldn't fill up your entire queue of.
Which actually maybe a similar idea. Maybe you could dynamically adjust based on how many open, half open ports you have, adjust down your timeout into where you're gonna drop those, right? Then the problem is, can the attacker send enough packets to continually fill that no matter how low you turn it? Or can the attacker get you to turn that so low that nobody can ever respond back to your SYNAC with a valid ACK because your threshold is longer than the time it takes for a packet to travel from them to the server? Yeah. So it's an interesting,
the attacker would have to know that those are the things you're actually doing in your system to try to prevent those kind of attacks.
Correct. Or if the defense doesn't work, they would have to know. And you could kind of assume that they know. Yeah.
Depending upon the system and the application nature, you could let the past predict the future and maintain a dictionary of hosts that have used your system recently.
Mm-hmm.
And so if out of the blue you start getting a billion requests all over the planet that are not people that have used your system before, you can deprioritize those connections.
Interesting. So we could essentially try to learn the behavior of our application and then more or less whitelist, in some sense, those hosts that we've talked to before. And so if they want to make a SYN connection to us, that would maybe go in a different queue than another one of hosts that we don't know. What's the fundamental, can we actually solve the fundamental problem? What is the fundamental problem so we know how to solve it? Yeah.
Is the fundamental problem that we have to store all the memory of everything that's incoming? So one idea is, couldn't we just send like another packet back directly from sent to it, just say try again later, rather than storing the information?
Yeah, so, going back, so the core problem is exactly that. We said that one single packet causes us to store data, but doesn't cause any data to have to be stored on the client, right? And so kind of going off of that idea is basically, well, what if we don't store that data? What if we essentially try to put it into our sequence number that we send back so that we actually don't have to store any data? And if we see an ACK packet back with an acknowledgement number, we can verify that it's actually correct. So we can filter, we can try to increase the length, reduce timeouts, these are all actually things that we're doing, drop it for a limit, and use SYN cookies. So SYN cookies are a super interesting thing. The idea is, what from the server's perspective, the reason why it's storing data is so that when it gets an ACK packet back, it can verify that, yes, this packet is in response to an already established TCP connection. So the idea is, hey, let's use an algorithm to try to inject that data into our sequence number that we send, and that way when they send us an ACK back, we can actually check that it's a valid sequence number. So it's a very cool process. And it's used. It uses hashes based on the source, destination, IP address, and pair. So it essentially, you can think of starts the initial sequence number of our connection based on the tuple, right? The four tuple of source IP, destination IP, source port, destination port, plus a counter that's changing. And then when we get back an ACK, we'll see this number plus one, so we can actually redo this calculation, right? We can check, we know the source and destination IPs, we know the destination source ports, and we can check, I think the idea is you essentially brute force here and check, wow, this is weird, okay. Too many wires. Oh, there we go. So anyways, the key idea here, I think the details here aren't exactly important. You can dive into this if you want to, but the idea is this actually is a setting you can enable in Linux to enable SYN cookies, so that way your server never stores any data in response to a SYN packet. It sends back a SYN ACK and then waits for an ACK, and then it can verify that that ACK was in response to a SYN ACK that it just sent after a certain timeout. Cool. There are also different types of these things. So the idea is if the server allocates memory, so this was specifically in response to a SYN, but maybe we can do a SYN ACK ACK, and maybe then the server will store memory that we don't have to store, so that can be another avenue of attack. How do web servers handle massive amounts of requests and concurrent requests? Yeah.
Spin up new virtual instances and message queue.
They can do that, but how, well, I guess I'll go more specific. How? What are the ways that Apache deals with that? Because Apache itself can't spin up a new instance of itself. So in normal programming, how do you handle concurrent requests?
Spin up another thread or another process, right?
You either have to spin up another thread or another process, right? You have to use either multi-threaded or multi-process approach, right? So those each have pros or cons, and web servers and most client-based servers work the same way, because when a connection comes in, if you block and can't accept any more connections until that request is processed, you're a terrible web server, right? You need to be able to handle hundreds of, even thousands of requests per second to hundreds of thousands of requests per second. And you're fundamentally not going to get there unless you do that. Or unless you take a completely different approach and just have a load balancer with tons of back-end servers that you can just spin up more of, but that load balancer itself has to do this anyways, right? So there's still this processing in here. And so, how many processes can you have on a Linux server? Is it infinite?
Isn't it 2 to the 16?
I actually don't know, so cool. Look that up, verify. 2 to the 16. I think that's right, it's like 65,000 or something? Is that 2 to the 16?
65,536.
Oh. I should have just gone with it. That looks much cooler. Right, so if every time I make a request to your web server, it forks, creates a new process, all I need to make is 65,000 requests and keep them open, and now literally nobody can make any more requests to your web server because Apache can't fork and the whole thing's gonna fail. Or with threads, there are limits to the number of threads you can have, and so similar things occur here. So. And it really does depend on the server application. Here you're moving less up from, previously we were thinking about attacking maybe the operating system's TCP/IP implementation, now we're moving up to attacking the application itself that's living there. So there's all kinds of fun attacks that you can play with here. So, questions on this? This is kind of a generalized approach and idea of how to tackle and identify denial of service vulnerabilities in networks and other types of, the ideas apply anywhere. Cool. All right, so, what is the, well, I can't think of a way to phrase this. So what are some mechanisms that we can use to protect our network? We've seen that there's a lot of games that you can play, a lot of bad stuff that can happen. So what do? We're just not safe? We just have to live with this fact? Is anybody ever worried about plugging a computer, brand new computer, in on their home network? No? Yeah, you used to. Why?
I guess we used to just connect it. Well, I don't remember exactly, but usually because the routers weren't, we use the routers, because there was no firewall between it and everything else.
So yeah, so okay, so the There used to be, and I don't know that this is true anymore, and I don't actually know if this was true in the past, but it used to be said that if you took a unpatched Windows XP machine and plugged it directly into the internet where it had a publicly routable IP address, in 10 minutes that machine would be infected with malware. Because there are worms running that are constantly scanning the IP address space and looking for vulnerable instances and automatically take them over and infect them. But why doesn't that happen anymore? Is it because now we're using Windows 10 and everything's awesome? Yeah, so I think we've done this before, but can somebody run ifconfig or I think that works both on Mac, on Linux and Windows. What's your IP address on the network here? 10 dot something?
Yeah.
10.0.0. So I think we talked about it briefly, but the 10 network space is a private network space, right? So why can you access the internet? How can Google talk to you? Does the router access your network gateway in what way? So what does that mean?
Well, it has a public IP address, which it then uses, what is it, address, ATN address translation, something or other, to translate your private address into its public address, and then it sends traffic out to the internet with its public address, and then when stuff comes back to it, it forwards it to you.
Cool. So the two things to separate there. So yeah, so we had this idea of a route, like a gateway or like a router, right? So that the important thing to remember is your router does act as a gateway router. It forwards packets where they need to go. But that's not all that it did. If that's all that it did, you would just be on their network, right? So NAT basically, I think it's, what is it, network?
Network address translation.
Yeah. So we're gonna, yeah, that's sure that's all right. All right, so we have our switch here. We have you with your laptop here. You're connected to the switch. The switch is connected to the world. So you have a 10.0.0.2 address. Your router is 10.0.0.1. And your public IP, anybody, can somebody go to ipchicken.com or whatsmyip.com and tell me what the ASU IP that you're using is? 209.147.144.7. Is that right? Ugly, but
right.
Okay.
This is different.
So that's somehow our external address.
His is.
Hmm?
His is different than mine.
Hmm. Interesting. That's like because ASU's network is crazy. in a good way. So Google is here. They have their own server that's going to handle your request. A lot of like blinking lights. And then they have some IP address, well, whatever, it doesn't matter, we'll call it G. So, our machine wants to send a packet to Google. They're gonna make a DNS request to figure out what's google.com's IP address, it's gonna come back as the IP, and then your computer is gonna make a packet. What kind of a packet if it wants to talk to the web server on HTTP port 80? Have an IP packet with a source of what? Yeah, 10.0.0.2 and the destination of Google. And what will be inside that IP packet? Yeah, TCP packet, right? Then we know this will be a SYN packet because I'm trying to initiate connection. And what's the destination port? Port 80, and somebody give me a number for source port.
62,000.
Something that's not crazy. All right, 2222, there you go. Needs to be high-ish, but not. Thanks for that. All right, you guys are bad random number generators, by the way. All right. So we send this packet out to the router. Now, if, like, like we talked about with indirect routing, the router then just takes this and says, great, okay, this is going to Google, I know how to send that out, it goes here, it gets to Google, and Google replies back with it, right? It's gonna try to reply to some private IP address, right, which Google itself may be using, right? The whole point of private IP addresses is they're not publicly routable. But you actually probably could send this packet out on the network. I don't know what would happen, but it would be interesting. So the router says, hey, I know my internal network is a private IP address range, and I need to talk to the outside world, and the outside world knows me at this IP address. So your router is actually going to change this packet around. And so it's going to put IP source, it's going to change the IP source to this 209, blah, blah, blah. And the destination, is it going to change the destination? Nope, still going to Google. What about the TCP layer? Does it sit, keep the TCP layer the same? Why? So let's take it one by one. Would it change the destination port? No, because then you're talking to something different. So what about the source port? Right. So let's think about it in two different ways. So like 2.2.2.2. So let's say it keeps it the same. Right? So this packet goes out, Google replies back with a SYN-ACK with the destination IP. 209.147.11 or one whatever this is. I should just call it A for ASU. The packet comes back. It has a source port of 80 and a destination port of 2.2.2.2. Then the router gets that. And what does the router then do with that response? Where does this packet need to go?
To the machine.
Back to us. The 10.0.0.2. Right. How does the router know how to change that header to send the packet back to 10.0.0.2?
Stores it based on the port number that it's set out of.
Yes, so it can keep a mapping and say, hey, I just sent a SYN packet to, actually could probably do more complicated and use the IP address, but I think it just uses the source port because there's enough. It says, hey, I just sent a packet out from 2.2.2.2. If I get a response back, I'm going to forward that to 10.0.0.2 and not 10.0.0.3 or any of the other machines on our network, right? But of course, what if there's 20 machines back here, they're all using their own source ports, and they all send out packets from port 2.2.2.2, right? And then the router would get confused and not know what to do. So what it does is it will actually not use the source port here, create its own sort random source port, let's say 4444, and then the router will store in its NAT table, hey, 4444 maps to 10.0.0.2. And then when another packet wants to get sent out, then it just creates a new one, adds a new entry in its table. So this is how it's translating, and basically pretending for the world to be 10.0.0.2, pretending for the world to be ASU 209.147.144.7, but it's translating all the packets you're sending and all the replies, so everything's great. What if you want to run your own web server behind this router? So what's the difference here? World use 10.0.0.2?
No.
So they have to use the public IP address.
So we'd be trying to contact the router, but the router doesn't know what to do.
Exactly. It'd be trying to contact a web server on the router. Hopefully it would reject that and not display its admin page. Otherwise that would be bad. And the whole problem is there is no mapping in this table that maps and says, where should I give this traffic to, right? Because you think, okay, it's easy when you're making a connection outgoing because you expect a response back, and I can tell what that response is. But if somebody's making a connection, how do I know it goes to 10.0.0.2 and not 10.0.0.4 or 5, 6, or any of these other machines? So this is where if you've run and messed with running, trying to run a SSH server or a web server from your home IP, you have to set up in your router and specifically add a rule that says, hey, actually, anything on port 80 is redirected to 10.0.0.2. And that's what that rule does. Basically says, hey, forward all traffic to port 80 directly to 10.0.0.2. And then people can contact you and everything works. Unless your IP, unless you're...
Then you get a cease and desist letter from Cox or something.
depends on what server you're running, so we won't address that. But part of this is your IP address usually doesn't remain constant. It can be a dynamic IP that's changing, so that would also be a thing. But anyways, so it seems like this is just kind of like a standard network thing that we all take for granted and don't really think about. Why does this actually offer security benefits here?
Until the router's set up to direct to you, it wouldn't know to direct to you, right? Like
nobody can contact you, right? So even if you're running on your system an insanely vulnerable Windows XP machine, at least we know that other malware, viruses, worms, whatever, they can't send any SYN packets and initiate any connections to your computer. Now, as you're browsing around on the web, you are bringing content in, so it's likely that at some point malicious JavaScript will find its way on there and exploit something in Flash and get onto your computer. But until that happens, nobody can connect to you. So it actually is a nice safeguard. And it's important to understand how this works for understanding. So actually, NAT is a decent kind of like first layer. I'd say, how do I phrase this? It's a decent, let's say, consumer or client level network defense mechanism. So you're basically saying, hey, I'm at my home, I don't want people to contact me, I'll only contact other places. This causes problems if anybody's ever tried to, usually like Xboxes or video game systems, sometimes if you don't connect to a central server to do online gaming and one of the players hosts a game, you have to have people connect to you. BitTorrent, right, you're having people connect to you, or Skype, part of the whole point of Skype is you use other people's bandwidth, so you connect to them. So there's super cool, I think it's, if you want to look at this, Stun is a really interesting protocol. The idea is, if I'm a program here and I'm running on port 80 and I want you to be able to talk to me on port 80, I can basically send out a packet, a fake SYN packet, that actually opens up that redirection backwards from the server. So anyways, there's like a whole, I think there's two different protocols. One was like a series of tricks and techniques to trick the NAT to opening up ports that would forward so that people could connect to you. There's also, I believe, protocols that an application can actually talk directly to the router and say, hey, I really want this port forwarded to me because I need people to contact me. But now let's put our shoes not in the us in our homes, but in the Google scenario, right? So with Google, NAT doesn't really make sense here because this machine needs to be accessible from an IP address, right? There has to be a way to talk to the web service. So what should, let's say, like a router with a NAT. So what are their options? Let's think about it this way. What are their options? What can they do? Okay, so one of the options is they could use basically a router, right, and set it up like we talked about to forward different traffic. What else could they do? The easy one is nothing, right? They could do nothing. They just put the computer, have it set a public IP address. That's fine. What's the downside there?
I
secret? No, everyone literally has to know this IP address in order to talk to us. If they can't talk to us, we don't make money. Everyone knows this IP address. So what? Let's say it's a web server, so we know what's running on it for sure. A web server, it's not your question. A web server, we know there's something running on port 80. Right? Is that it? What else might be running on, reasonably be running on this server?
A firewall?
Not thinking about that yet.
Okay.
SSH. SSH. Port 22. Right? Why would you think that it'd be reasonable for SSH to be running on that server?
People don't want to physically go to the machine every time they need to change something.
Yeah. Remember, Google has literally thousands upon thousands of these servers. They do not want to have to go into it and type in things. You need to be able to remotely administer these tools. And SSH is an excellent tool for that, right? So you clearly want an SSH port, an SSH service open. What else?
Service as well?
Sure. Yeah. SMTP.
HTTPS.
Maybe they have port, what is it, 25? HTTPS. 443. There we go. Thank you. Maybe LDAP, which is like a directory service, which I have no idea what port this is. I don't remember. Somebody looks it up, let me know. Right? They have all these services. So now it comes down to a
389.
What is it?
389.
389. Nice. I will not remember that. Cool. So all these ports, all these services running. But if we think about it in terms of authorization, who should be allowed to, is EPCHO? Should everyone be allowed to access all these services?
No.
No, why not? Which ones? No.
Probably not SSH.
Probably not SSH. Why?
Because you don't want people even attempting to log in if they happen to guess or brute force the password.
So who would you want to be able to access port 22?
Google employees.
Google employees, or maybe somebody, because we got to think, so this is the public internet, and then this is somehow Google's network, right? So we want port 22 only on the internal network. What about port 80? Can we restrict that? No, probably not. We shouldn't, right? Because we want people to access port 80. What about 443? Yeah, the same thing. We want people to access that. What about the LDAP server, which has our corporate directory and all the people who work in our company? Probably not as well. That should probably also be internal network. What about SMTP? It's tricky. I think the answer is it depends on what this is for in the company. If this is like the Gmail SMTP server, then clearly it needs to be world accessible. If not, it wouldn't make sense. Like, so we gotta think about it in terms of going back to talking about the attack surface, right? So if we think about every single port we have accessible to the world means that anybody in the world can make a request to that port. So if somebody finds a vulnerability in one of the services that is listening on that port, that means they can get into our servers and propagate from there. So we want to restrict the attack surface and only allow what things we actually want people to access. So how do we actually do that? Like, what mechanisms do we have available to do that? Yeah, so let's add basically a little box here. Yeah. So we can put something there that acts as our network enforcement mechanism, that we can make rules that say to whatever, server G only allow traffic to port 80 and 443. That's it, nothing else. Don't allow access to, I mean, block all the other ports. So the way to think about it, and the way I think about it, is that essentially, to enforce some network security policies. So this is why we spent so much time at the beginning of the class talking about mechanisms and policies, because this is what everything is, right? So then the policy becomes, what do we actually want to block, right? Are there blanket statements of what we want to block? That apply to every company and every server?
Inbounding packets that aren't established.
So maybe, the answer is it maybe, it depends, right? So we may want to, we may, if our firewall is smart enough and we can say, hey, don't accept, drop any SYN-ACK packets that you didn't see an initial SYN for or something like that, right? You could try to restrict the traffic so it's only good traffic. But, so it really comes down to, so firewalls come down to how you specify the policy, right? And really how expressive is that policy? Can you express, so think about this, how would you implement this, or what would you look for in the firewall? If you said, so, if we think about the Google server should be able to accept incoming connections, right, to web. Right? Should that Google server ever make outgoing connections? Yes, why? When?
Do you want to connect with other server to get traffic?
Yeah, so it depends, right? It depends on what you're doing. Maybe you're fetching Twitter data or Twitter API for something. Well, let's say that's handled on some other backend server that's not this server. This server just serves up web content. In that case, we wouldn't want to allow, we would want to restrict that server so it can't make any outgoing connections, because that's not what its job is, right? That's not how it should function. So if there's any packets going out, that could be an attacker on our system initiating some request to try to leak some data back. But the question is then, so there, we're not going to get into all the different types. You can look this up, the various types of firewalls, stateware firewalls, not stateware firewalls. But some of them can't express this notion, right? Which, as we know, goes back to SYN packets. So it means that the firewall itself should not send any outgoing SYN packets, right? So it, we should drop any packet that has a source IP of the server and has a SYN flag set. That would stop all outgoing packets, but not every firewall can do that. Some of them maybe only can target IPs and ports. And so some other limitations of a firewall are, one of the main ones is that we don't, we have our nice internal network here, which has server, can you guys see that? Yeah, okay. Has server A, server B, server C. So, can this firewall control the communication between A, B, and C? No. It only sees the outgoing traffic. So this is actually one of the major flaws of kind of the current thinking about firewalls is it's very moat-based thinking of like, oh, we have our internal network, and so we just need a firewall to protect us from all the garbage on the outside. When that ignores all of the internal attacks that can happen. So if any of these internal machines ever gets compromised, it's very easy to, there's no protection there, yeah.
Is there any benefit to having the firewall running on a separate physical machine as opposed to an abstraction layer with a big configuration file in the web server or the router itself?
Right, so good question. Well, what does the class think? So to reiterate, what do you mean?
depends on what you would, what you need your firewall to do. Like if you wanted to set it up on its own server, you're gonna, its own separate unit, like you're gonna be able to do more with it. And as opposed to if you have just a firewall on your personal computer, like parts of your, it's not, your personal computer isn't dedicated solely to the firewall property. So, I mean, you know.
Right, so it comes back to what we talked about is what's your threat model, right? What are the threats you're worried about, right? If, so let's say I put the firewall essentially on this web server and somebody compromises the web server through some Apache exploit. And then through that, they're able to use a local root exploit to get root on my system. Now what can they do to my firewall? Disable it, completely get rid of it, right? Because it's on the same system, right? However, if my firewall is a separate box that literally just only essentially looks at packets and either drops them or allows them to go through, there's very few ways. The attack surface there is significantly reduced in the fact that it would be hard to compromise, let's say, an inline firewall like this. However, there definitely, it depends on, as we, I think we've talked about with the switches and hubs, it depends on the failure mode of this firewall. So there have been attacks against firewalls that they cause the firewall to crash. And so when the firewall crashes, rather than stopping all traffic, it does what we call fail open, where it just fails and all packets go through, so your firewall is completely disabled and useless. So they all have pros and cons, and it depends on, you know, these boxes. I mean, to get a separate box, it's expensive, right? And the firewall included in Linux comes with the server, so you have to consider those types of things in there. Probably the best way to think about it would be a combination of both, where you're looking at not only, you should, each server itself should be restricted to only do what it needs to do on its own, and then also have other mechanisms of restricting those as well, kind of a defense in depth strategy. Great. So, you're an organization, are you under attack? Yes. The answer is yes, you're always under attack. It really doesn't matter how big of an organization you are. I guess if you literally just bought a brand new computer and put it in your garage to do a startup, you'd probably not yet be under attack. But as soon as you connect it to the internet, you're pretty much under attack. Have you been compromised?
Probably not.
Probably not. Why not? Not in that scenario. Go back to a general, you're in some organization that's not a tiny startup that you just created with a fresh computers. You're in some organization. Are you compromised?
You don't know, right?
You don't know. Do you want to know?
Yeah.
Yeah. You definitely want to know. So how do you know?
Hire a forensics consultant.
Forensics consultants are very good after the fact. So a forensics consultant can go in, check all your logs, assuming you actually have the correct logs and have a logging infrastructure set up, and they can figure out what happened. But they may not be able to tell you that you're actually currently infected. It all depends, because they have different focus, right? But we know that you want to know if you were under attack, right? I mean, that's kind of step one. And so that's the other major kind of network security defense. So make two big things you'll hear about a lot, firewalls, which we just talked about, and intrusion detection systems. The idea here is basically this is a mechanism that acts similarly in some sense to the firewall, where it's monitoring all the traffic, but instead of dropping traffic that doesn't match a certain policy, it's going to try to determine is either this machine or is another machine compromised. And that would be really the goal, because you want to see, it's an intrusion, right? You want to see, is my system compromised? Is there somebody inside my network? Question is, how do you do this?
Well,
you're building one, let's say a task queue is building one, how do you do it?
Inspect all the network traffic.
Inspect all the network traffic and do what?
Well, you have to operate on predefined rules that are...
How do you come up with those rules?
Someone has to write them.
Someone has to write them? How do they write them?
Based on, your policy would determine network traffic that you deem to be malicious, and you'll search for that, and hopefully be constantly vigilant on new trends in updating your rules to reflect and search for those.
Any other ideas? Ridiculous false positives, so you can run this on your system and it will just alert, 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 and all all of them will be false positives that weren't actual alerts. So the downside of an intrusion detection system is basically, it just tells you that you're compromised, right? So some things we talked about, we need to actually have confidence that our intrusion detection system is going to tell us when it's compromised, and so an attacker can't exploit the IDS itself. It's kind of a counterintuitive thing, right? It's like, why would I spend $10,000 to buy something that tells me that I've been compromised? It's like a security guard with like a whistle, right? He just like blows the whistle, and it's like, great, cool, we're seeing a robbery in progress. Awesome, it's better than not knowing you've been robbed, right? But what you want is maybe a prevention system that actually acts like a firewall in the sense that it's in line and can drop offending packets. This has all of the downsides of an IDS of false positives, but now you're gonna drop actual real traffic, which could cost you business and money. This is actually something, if somebody wants to, I don't remember all the details, it's probably still true, so I think I mentioned this before. ASU definitely has an intrusion prevention system or some kind of firewall system that looks in the packets to see what's going on, because I've hit it two ways. One was doing a web security assignment on my own server and not being able to send cross-site scripting payloads because they were just getting dropped somewhere. So I switched to HTTPS and everything works. It's all encrypted, so they can't see the packets. The other thing was, we were looking at web vulnerability scanners, and these tools send an HTTP header called like x-scan-with, and then the name, like the name of the tool. And so what we found out by playing with it is if we scanned out like another website from inside ASU, those requests would never get there because ASU would drop, like I shouldn't say ASU, the firewall would drop all those packets. So then we were like, huh, I wonder how smart that thing is, right? Like, where does it actually look? And it doesn't look for any HTTP header, it actually just looks for the words X scanned with whatever the scanner's name was anywhere in the header. And one of the header fields is the referrer, where you came from. So if I send you a link to something and the page that you're on includes this keyword, when you click that link, you actually can't visit that link, like that next request gets dropped. I actually couldn't turn it into something super interesting, but it was a weird instance of like these intrusion prevention systems. They're not foolproof in both ways. They may miss stuff and they may accidentally block other stuff. Yeah. So
that sounds fishy to me, because it was looking for a keyword in a single packet, and let's assume that the dictionary of its bad keywords was rather large. Would that increase the latency astronomically that it was analyzing? Ransacking your packets looking for these bad things?
It was just in the header, right?
It's in the HTTP header, so it doesn't look in the body of the message, so that's less of the packets, but it definitely, there are performance impacts, but there's also really cool ways to get around that. So there's some approaches I've seen where they use GPUs to do this kind of intrusion detection. They can do it crazy fast in parallel, so it's almost no noticeable delay, all kinds of cool stuff. So an IPS must be in line, right? For it to drop something, it needs to be in line. Whereas an intrusion detection system, if it gets a copy of every packet that gets sent, most switches have like a tap device or have a way to set up a certain port to either mirror another port or mirror certain ports, then you can actually see all the traffic there. So usually you get a copy. But we saw you could play all these kind of games with packets, right? We don't have to send the whole payload in one TCP packet, right? We can actually send it byte by byte, one byte at a time. So then you have to think, well, is this IDS or IPS going to actually, when it gets a packet, is it going to keep track of the whole stream that I've been sending, or is it going to either accept it or block it at that point? And most of them make the decision right then. Or you can play crazy IP fragmentation games that we talked about and like break your packet up into different IP fragments, which some of these things can't actually correctly assemble, and so you can do super cool stuff like that. Cool. Okay, so these are really the kind of current generation of these tools. And so going forward, so network security research, the ideas are we want, there are actually a lot of different ways here. So there's a, I mean, my lab's doing research into software-defined networking, which is essentially, has anybody set up and configured a like router or switch before, like a decently sized one? How did you do it? You go into a stupid web interface and you have to change and set up, and if you set up any VLANs, you have to...
We consoled in, basically set up each individual interface and then set up routing tables, connected that to a wireless access controller, then to an access point.
Yeah, it's a huge pain, right?
Yeah, it's
exactly.
Takes hours.
And when you want to go change something, you have to dig up the credentials to get to that switch to say, actually, we want to change it like this. So the idea behind software-defined networking says, hey, let's make the switches dumb. Super dumb switches that actually don't know what to do. And when they get a packet in, they'll actually ask a centralized component called the controller, hey, what do I do with this packet? And then the controller will install rules on each of the switches to tell it how to forward those packets. So then you can think, rather than your network infrastructure and your network, we'll say configuration, to be distributed inside all of these different switches, you actually remove all that out into a central location that has a view of your entire network and can make intelligent decisions about where to route and where traffic should go. So you can do super cool things, and they've actually built it in a similar style where you can build apps on top of that controller. So you can add a load balancing app that would actually at a network level do load balancing. So super cool stuff there. Other areas of research, there's IPv6, which we didn't even talk about, or we briefly mentioned that vastly increases the IP address space. There's IPsec, which actually tries to build in. We said some of the key problems at the IP level is that the source IP and the destination IP are completely spoofed, the packet's not protected at all, anybody can see anything that's inside that packet. And so IPsec has different ways of doing this and of building really cool security around there. So there's, network security research, there's a ton of areas here. How to build better intrusion detection systems, intrusion prevention systems, literally everything we talked about, the current state is basically that everything sucks. But it's getting better, and so research is trying to push that forward to make things better. So, all right, cool. We are right on time.